I can remember standing in my first teacher's solo exhibition in the early 80s and looking around and thinking, this is what I want to do. It's challenging and interesting, and I'll still be doing this, you know, till I fall over, because there's no way in the world that I could ever get to a point of knowing everything about this. I guess I felt that if I had that, I would never run out of things to keep me. There would always be something else that I needed to know about. In a way, I think you're lucky if you can find something that suits you. And so, I guess in my experience, the characteristics that I've already got, I need to work with clay. And so they've enhanced those, but then thrown up challenges at the same time. So I'm interested in sort of things like problem solving and science and art and form and unpredictability and things like that. So those sorts of things that I'm already interested in, and building and, you know, working with my hands and stuff like that. Those sorts of things that I'm already interested in are enhanced by clay, because there's bucket loads of that stuff that has to happen. To reference Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance, he talks there about steel and how steel has no form. It's dug out of the ground as ore, it's made then into steel, and then it's the energy and the time that humans put into it that make it into things, whether that's a fork or a motorcycle engine or a gun or a car or something, so useful, not useful things. And I can really relate to that in regards to clay, because clay in itself doesn't have a grain, you know, it has a character that you've got to deal with. But really, it's a lot about the energy you put into the clay that tends to be things, what comes out the other end. So for me, what I've found is that it's allowed me, in one way, to subconsciously, more than consciously, express what's going on with me internally. But I can only really see that in retrospect. I could easily spend 25 hours a day working and trying to solve things and never, you know, just never get there, you know, because there's just so much to deal with. And, you know, that's, there is, and, you know, and I know we're talking about my practice, and part of my practice, though, is tied to teaching and working with people. And it's very difficult for me to separate the two, I guess, because they've always been tied together. But it is a play, and it is, I can sit home in my studio and work, but it just doesn't have the same satisfaction as being around other people who are working. And whether that takes place at workshops and conferences or in the studio here, in a teaching studio, then it's part of that process that you're always being questioned. And I find that by my own practice is always questioned by other people's practice, whether they're beginners or experienced, because I will always look at what they're doing and see, you know, would I do it that way, or is that a better way to do it? Or and so often people with little experience come to a place where they do things that you wouldn't normally do because it's outside of tradition. And I find that really interesting and stimulating. So it's important, those two things are quite intertwined. So, you know, working with clay and myself and making my own work and working with people is sort of something that's always been part of my practice and is important in my practice. And I realise too that it's, you know, it's important to my practice, but it's sort of, it gives me a lot of satisfaction too. So without that, there'd be it wouldn't be as rich a life. Pieces that I like would be the really big solid slabs, pushed and pulled and stretched and sort of, gently encouraged but manipulated, and then have a very heavy, intense firing process. And so there's this build up of layers over a really sort of solid, thick body, so that sort of layering effect. They're probably the pieces I like the most. In those pieces then I'd want, you know, they're simple because they're just a slab of clay, but they're complex because there's lots of layers and there's lots of interaction between clay and glaze and the atmosphere. And there'll be areas, you know, on a good piece, there'll be areas that go from, you know, variation of colour, from white, from black, from red to green, smooth areas to matte areas to really crusty areas. So, you know, complexity, but in a simple sort of form, in a way. So, in a way, looking at probably traditional Japanese Korean pots that have a simple quietness but also a more complex sort of look. So playing with those sort of those areas and sort of pulling those apart is what really, I guess, where my work, I'm trying to make my work. So that's where I'm trying to put my work. We just have to leave it up to time to work out whether I achieve that. And as I said, you can't really the things that work sometimes at the time, and then in retrospect they don't, and vice versa. So the usual sort of run with a firing is that you start making the big work first, because that takes the longest to dry and deal with. So at the moment I'm making some plates, and I've done those for a long period of time, and they've changed in form over time, that stuff. And in a way, I mean, in the process of thinking about this sort of idea, it's interesting that I find that form one of my favourite forms, in that to me a bowl can do just about anything. I've always liked bowls, and bowls can do anything. You can eat a steak out of a bowl, you can drink your soup, you can drink coffee, you know, whatever. You can do, you only need a bowl really. And so in that way, these are essentially bowls, or big flat bowls. And I've always liked open bowls because there's a sense of openness and generosity and that sort of... I come from a family where food is important and sharing food is important. So ceremonial, you know, that sort of that ritual is part of our family history. And I've realised that that's sort of one of the ways that we connect as a family. And so these platters, you know, in a way represent that openness and generosity and, you know, the bowl and, you know, that sort of giving in a way, that serving and giving. The other pieces I'm making are essentially a scale up. So I'm making some sort of slab forms, and they're a scale up of smaller pieces that I've made. And so essentially, while some of the pieces that I've made, I've probably had pieces that maybe 8 to 10 centimetres thick, solid clay, big chunks of clay. And they start to get problematic once you get bigger than that. And so I wanted to scale those up. And so these are the sort of prototypes in a way of that process, and increasing those to, you know, 12 centimetres thick, and sort of, you know, 50 by 50 centimetres in square. And so they essentially look like big slabs, and the idea is that they'll sort of look like solid pieces of clay. In the right circumstance, I can make them out of solid pieces of clay, and that could work, and certainly I don't have an issue with that. I just wanted to try another way of seeing, sort of going about it. So they're sort of, yeah, the scaled up version of things that I've been making in a way. And that also is that sort of, you know, serving idea, but it in a way these ones are more sculptural and more about that sort of volume and thickness but stillness. And, you know, that the idea will be that they'll be quite solid, heavy looking pieces, but they'll tend to float. So playing with those two ideas of having a mass but being light on your feet, so to speak. So we've got another bung of shells going here. This is a firebox full. So most of the fire will be here. So we have a bung of shells that goes up here. So I'm just working out, we've got different size shells and we've got this big open void here. So if you leave this too open, once the flame comes up, it's gonna oxidize, probably oxidize too much. So this is gonna be a really hot part of the kiln, but we want to put pots basically here.
This is a very intense part of the firing part of the kiln. Gets lots of coals, lots of wood thrown on things. Got to be fairly robust.
For me, one of the most important things I did was my research when I was doing my postgrad. My understanding and the available literature at the time didn't really place a lot of emphasis on the cooling of the kiln. And so my research essentially looked at that and showed that that was really important. I guess so it's important in the way that, in particularly in wood firing, extended wood firing, which is sort of where I like to finish my work, which is a lot of labour, a lot of time, a lot of effort. And usually by the end of the firing, which might take up to 4 or 5 days, you're exhausted. And so the last thing you want to do is be making decisions about what's going on with the kiln. More often than not, what would normally happen would be that you just we got to temperature, or this is long enough, or we've run out of wood, or something's happened. Let's just shut the kiln down and go to sleep. You know, so that's normally what would happen in most circumstances. But it's important in that the glazes are still fluid, reactions are still taking place, and what happens to the kiln after that point in time will make a huge difference to colour and surface and a whole bunch of things going on inside the kiln. That was sort of acknowledged in a way that people were looking at reduction cooling and oxidised cooling, but there was a lot of myth around if you did certain things would happen. And so while there is still no way that you can say, if I do this, this will happen, because there's too many variables involved, if for no one else, I clarified what the different atmospheres would do at different temperatures in regards to surface texture, surface colour, and reactions in the clay and the glaze and the kiln. And so really then, essentially, I guess that what I'm saying is that getting to the end of the firing is half the story. There's the rest of it is at the important, it's the end chapters, you know. It's the most important thing. It's like getting to the end of the book and the last two chapters are missing. You know, like, okay, you've got most of the story, but you don't know what's going to go on at the end. And so ignoring that process, then essentially, if you think about how much time and energy it's taken to make the pots and glaze the pots and fire the pots and all of that stuff, you think about all of that energy, and then suddenly for the sake of 8 hours or 10 hours or 12 hours or 24 hours, you're just going to throw all that away, days and days of work, and not get what you want. I mean, you know, I don't know. That's okay if you want to do it, but I guess in my process, what I like to do is have maximize my opportunities for good results. And that doesn't mean control them totally. It just means put a whole bunch of things in place so there's a good chance something nice is going to happen. I don't want to be in a position where I've got absolute control and I know exactly how things are going to go. The reality is I can't do that in wood firing anyway, so that, you know, that's one of the reasons that I enjoy it so much. But being able to sort of go, well, okay, you know, if we do this, then there's a good chance we'll get these sorts of results, or, you know, this will sort of happen. So it's more about that sort of hypothesis and testing it and having some sort of informed decision. Kilns, like ovens, are all slightly different, and particularly since they're handmade, hand-built, and they have their own little intricacies, you start to work out what you need to do to get what you want, or close to what you want. So we've started to work that out. So unfortunately, this is the last firing in this kiln, just because that land's being developed and turned into a housing estate. Overall, it went really well. It was a struggle during the firing. The kiln ended up being wet through sprinklers being left on. The wood was good. Everything seemed pretty good, but It was, you know, Dan turned out to be a struggle with firing. We had some issues with the chimney. Once we sorted that though, and then sort of really paid really minute detail to the kiln, and it was so finely tuned that literally we were going two little bits of timber in the side stoke areas to gain temperature. Any more than that was actually slowing the kiln down. So for most of the firing, we had very strong reduction and lots of carbon webbing and some really interesting effects. But that, it's an interesting sort of process in that it's not all about the maximum temperature. It's not all about getting that complete, that top temperature. It's often about time. There's numbers of ways of looking at of whether we're firing successful or not. Sometimes it's because you get a couple of really amazing pots, and so you might only get a small number of really amazing pots. Another way to look at it is the average of good pots. In this firing, we had not too many bad pots, which was good. So there's a fairly high sort of success rate with most pieces. And then scattered in among that was some really nice pieces. So I think, you know, overall it was the best firing out of that kiln. And unfortunately we won't get the opportunity to continue that process, but that's the way it is. Getting flatware and large flatware through a kiln in this sort of circumstance where there's lots of variation in temperature in heating and cooling is a bit of a struggle. I used a new clay, a different clay that's a lot very gritty to try and combat that stress, and that seemed to work out okay. And on top of that, I had slips, and I was getting the slip to the thickness that was actually starting to develop colour and ash glaze and stuff. And oh, here's Bubba.
You've got my hair.
Okay, Bubba. And so that was, you know, the clay body was good. There was a couple of them cracked in the cooling. Slip was good. Position in the kiln was okay. Yeah, it was a good result. It wasn't great. You know, I could have done with a lot more ash on them and a lot more run. But there's potential of ways of, you know, it leads on to the next thing, basically. I think it's very rare that I've been making those pieces for a long time, and it's very rare that you get to a point where you're totally satisfied, you know, because that means you stop, you know. So there's other ideas that these have, different ideas that these have encouraged me to sort of continue with. So I have to wait for that installment. I think for me, clay in a really broad sense, or working with clay, there will never be a point where I can say I've mastered this or I know everything. There's just so much to know, so much to learn, so many avenues to explore that it's never ending. And sometimes that's daunting, but in a lot of ways, it's like, I'm going to keep doing this until I fall off the perch. You know, like you can't retire from it because you never get to a point of having enough. The work might get, you know, more refined or smaller or different, or I can't lift it anymore, but I could still work with it. And so in a lot of ways, it's an area that has an unlimited sense of, well, unlimited potential of working with it. And so I think I like that idea. You have to be an optimist to work with clay. And so it makes, you know, if you're not, then you just get so miserable you don't want to do it anymore. So you sort of have to be. You have to see the bright side and see the good things. And so even if you're not, you have to be. You know, so it's challenging, and it's got all those sorts of things that just keep going.
Pretty happy with it on first impressions.
Yeah.
This rutting ash is good, you know, and there's variation across the surface. All of this cracking and crazing in the slip is good. It was leaned against something, so there's sort of this shadow area, but so there's variation across the whole surface, which is what I want. It just would have been nice if it had come out one piece. So the porcelain slip, and you can see that on that side, how where it's been, this is the edge it was sitting on, but where the shell was, so there's a reaction around the porcelain. But yeah, this, you know, running ash and black and through to oranges and stuff.
I think that's the nice thing about wood firing, in a way. While there's lots of other stuff going on, the nicest thing I could do with making work would be to be able to go, right, okay, I'm wood firing. So it would be, you know, might be an 8 or a 12 hour shift, and you're on the kiln, and otherwise you're eating and sleeping, and so you just have that total focus. And I guess it's, you know, ties into all of that meditation practice and stuff that people do, and that idea about being focused and in the moment, blah blah blah. So all of that stuff is actually what you're doing when you're firing with wood, because you don't, it's easy to it's very easy to get distracted, and even in a wood firing. And so, you know, I'll get the groans from the young'uns when I go, right, turn the radio off, we've got to listen to the kiln, you know, because they want to listen to their top 40 or whatever. But we'll listen to the kiln, and you can hear the kiln, the chimney crack, and that means it's time to stoke and all those sorts of things. So in a lot of cases, if you're doing it properly, you're really focused on what's going on. You know, it's irrelevant that about 2 kilometres away a storm's going to hit and completely wipe you out, because you're not looking around at the sky, you're looking at the kiln. And so, yeah, I guess that sort of, that connection and that focus. And so that's, you know, that's a nice thing to do. And I guess I try to do that in a lot of parts of my life. So if I'm with, you know, Kizzy and Seraphine, I'm with Kizzy and Seraphine. If I'm here, I'm teaching. If I'm at the wood kiln, I'm firing a wood kiln. And so it's probably about that being in the moment. I guess inherently I'd rather go, you know, surfing and fishing than to Dream World, or drive through the countryside than, I don't know, sit in a resort or something. So I guess there is something there that connects, that I like to be connected to the environment and those elements. And so in a way then, clay is very much about that. It's not removed from that. The things that we use, particularly in wood firing, which is essentially, as you say, you know, clay and wood, and a handful of bricks and a modicum of knowledge gets us to achieve those results. And so it is elemental, but in the same way it's, I think, in one way it's primitive, but in another way it's very sophisticated, because you've limited your palate in a way, you've limited what you can use, and so you've really got to use that as well as you possibly can. Oh, I guess work with, I mean, if I wanted to be a bit immodest, it'd be work with character. So in a way, I guess I try on some level to make my work about me, or work that I like, I guess, and so my character comes through. And in that sense then, I'm trying to, you know, often it'll be, the clay might be fairly sort of robust and heavily fired and things like that, but at the same time that might be next to some tiny little porcelain, thin porcelain, translucent cups. Looking at the way I do things, I like to finish things. So it's a sort of that finishing stuff, you know, finish the job, get it done. Don't leave it half finished.